And in particular, this time we're going to focus a little bit more on the aspect of nurturing and restoring God's creation. But before we get started, let's go ahead and begin with a opening prayer. If y'all can read that, you're welcome to join along. So in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we praise the mighty power of God that made the mountains rise, that spread the flowing seas abroad, and built the lofty skies. We praise the wisdom that ordained the sun to rule the day. The moon shines full at his command, and all the stars obey. We praise the goodness of the Lord that filled the earth with food. He formed the creatures with his word, and then pronounced them good. Lord, how your wonders are displayed wherever we turn our eyes. If we survey the ground or gaze upon the sky, there's not a plant or flower below but makes your glories known, and clouds arise and tempests blow by order from thy throne. While all that borrows life from thee is ever in thy care, and everywhere that man can be, you, God, are present there. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. So that's actually a hymn, but I really like it. I think it kind of fits very well together with this encyclical, and just kind of tells us that, brings together this idea that Pope Francis talks about with integral ecology, of course, with nature, with mankind. God is present to all of it, to all of us, and bringing all of creation together. And God is always present throughout all of creation. So just wanted to, for folks that weren't here last week, just to kind of give a little recap of, I say part one, this was actually part one, my part one. Deacon Jerry also had two parts before that, and those are online as well. But last week, what I talked about a little bit was that creation is a gift from our loving Creator. In fact, creation itself, sometimes church teachings kind of talk about this as kind of flowing from God's love, okay, and the fact that God doesn't need creation, but it's out of his love that creation comes about. And not only does it come about one point in time, but God sustains creation, okay, that's sustained and created out of love. And we are called to be stewards of this gift of creation. And it's very important for us to kind of realize that this is a role, an important role that God entrusts to us. And in Genesis, God gives Adam and Eve the charge to till and keep the earth. And Pope Francis uses that phrase, and when he talks about that, he kind of breaks it into talking about keeping the earth as kind of referring more to like protection. And that's really what we talked about quite a bit last week. And in particular, we talked about different aspects of creation, of protection of creation. So we talked about anything from forestry, forests and fisheries, to protecting water and air and soil. But protection of the environment, and in particular, to make sure that the environment is protected so that we can use it sustainably. So in other words, we're not overexploiting these kind of these resources that we need, but that also future generations will need too. So it's entrusted to us, but we have to pass it on to our descendants too. So we want to make sure that we're using it sustainably. And one thing that I pointed out was something that Pope Francis talks about at a couple of points in his encyclical, but talking about protection even when there's no use to us. So in other words, we can look at it from kind of an idea of a lot of resources that we use them, right? So thinking about forests providing timber or fisheries, foods, and so on, that makes sense. But the Pope talks about even say creatures that don't necessarily have a use to us should still be protected. And we're going to talk about that a little bit more today too. But I've got a picture here of a species that's found down in Ocala and down into like the Lake George, like the center part of the state here in Florida, a Florida scrub jay that is protected. It's a federally threatened bird. I don't know of any use of a scrub jay. It doesn't necessarily have any kind of particular use for humankind, but it gives glory to God just by the fact that it exists. And so we want to make sure that Florida scrub jays are around for, you know, our grandkids, our great-grandkids to see too. And we talked about protection of creation occurring at different levels. So anything from local, like state, you know, parks, green spaces, and so on, to state levels, and all the way up to global levels of this protection can occur. And I brought in the concept towards the end of talking about how we can kind of think about subsidiarity, which is kind of a long word, but basically what that means, whether you're talking about social programs or environmental protection, that we want to think about the right level of protection occurring at the right scale. So if something can happen locally, let's say if it's an example of whether a shopping mall should be built in your neighborhood, we want to handle that at the local level rather than having it something at the national level have to come in and say what's happening in your backyard. But sometimes issues are so big that they have to be handled at a larger level. So when we look at things like, and I used the example last week of talking about the hole in the ozone and talking about the CFC production, so from like different materials like hairspray that had chlorofluorocarbons in it, a chemical that can get into the atmosphere, react with the ozone, and can actually destroy it. Well, globally, different governments came together to say, this is a real big problem, and we need to do something about it. So they passed different regulations that prevented those CFCs from being used in products, and we saw that the ozone hole kind of stopped growing larger, and actually it seems to be healing itself now because of those actions. But that's obviously not something that your neighborhood local homeowners association can tackle. That requires a higher level of protection. Okay, so that's been kind of looking at keeping or protection. What we're going to move to today is to talk a little bit more about tilling. So in other words, Pope Francis uses the verbs of like cultivating, nurturing, and restoring, and we'll try to look at some different aspects of this in relation to creation today. All right, so thinking about humanity and creation, how we relate to creation, Pope Francis talks about how indigenous communities, for them, the land isn't not seen as a commodity, but rather a gift from God and from their ancestors. And their ancestors are resting there, so it's seen as a sacred space. And talking about how this is so important for them, and in fact, we do see that as being where we know that for Native peoples, they're strongly connected to creation. And they don't take more than they need. They live what I was just talking about, that sustainably using resources. And of course, as Pope Francis talks about, giving thanks to they're very thankful to the gods of the forest and the animals of the forest because they see that as being the food that's, they're literally getting the food that they're providing for their families, the water that they're getting, and they're giving thanks for that. And this just brings up the idea that we can see that in their cultures, they're very much connected to nature. And so one of the things that we have to kind of look at is for ourselves, are we thankful for a lot of the things that we have? For example, for our food. I mean, this is just a picture from a shopping center, okay, or from a grocery store. We have a dizzying amount of food available to us, and a lot of us have never really gone to bed hungry, right, in our culture. And it's easy to maybe take for granted the fact that food is always available. Or how about clean running water? This is something that in our country we're very blessed to have. To have water for purification, to have the water delivered, and not only that, the temperature we want it to be at, right? I mean, this is really a blessing. And the same thing goes for a lot of our other things that we may take for granted. So, thinking about our power, our electricity, being able to get from one point to another relatively quickly, we don't have to worry about that for the most part. And so, the question is, and this is something that the Pope talks about, is that, are we becoming more and more disconnected from nature? The Pope talks about, how we were really not meant to be inundated by cement, by asphalt, by glass, by metal, deprived of physical contact with nature. And this is something that, in particular, now I work for the U.S. Forest Service, and one thing that we're kind of concerned about is, especially with kids, are becoming less and less connected with nature. So I don't know if any of you have seen some of these billboards of Discover the Forest, and there's also like More Kids in the Woods kind of programs, but we're really trying to say, is that even if you're in the middle of a city, there's probably some kind of green space that you can get out and enjoy that's really not that far away. And so there's great resources on there for like teachers, for families to look at. And we've got public service announcements on television, radio, and so on, really trying to get the word out there because we really feel that this is a problem, that if kids don't understand what nature is, about why we need to have clean water and the role that forests play and providing habitat and so on, that they won't see the need to say, spend money, taxpayers' money, on these kind of resources for the future that they really are important. So you want people to understand that. So getting back to this idea of sustainably, now if we're disconnected from nature, it's easy to see that unlike, say, indigenous tribes, it's maybe easier for us to use nature in a way that's not as sustainable. So the question is, are we currently using water, soil, you know, fossil fuels and other resources sustainably? And if not, are we borrowing from the future? And the Pope talks about, this was a quote I shared last week, but basically, you know, we are tasked with being stewards, but it's not to say that we can't use the resources that we need. But what the Pope is talking about here is making sure that we're using what we need and not more than that. And then the second part of this that I didn't play up as much last week, but we're going to try to get into this a little bit more, is making sure that it's fruitfulness for coming generations. So in other words, this is kind of related to last week. I talked about this idea of environmental health. And so what are we passing on? Are we passing on resources that are basically in the same kind of shape or even better to our descendants? Or are we passing on less and less quality, say, environment? You know, is the water the same kind of quality and the air quality and so on? So we have to think about what are we providing to coming generations? So just a few things to set the stage here. You know, in the last 50 years, the human population has doubled from about 3 to, we just passed 7 billion recently. But here's something that's pretty interesting that a lot of people don't realize, is that our use of food and water has actually tripled in that same amount of time, and our use of fossil fuels has quadrupled. So if we go back to this basically means that we're using, on average, per person, more water and food and more fossil fuels than we were 50 years ago. So this tends to kind of point out that, looking at, are we using things sustainably? Well, we're definitely using more per person, per capita, than we did 50 years ago. And Pope Paul VI actually talked about this several decades ago, and he says, due to an ill-considered exploitation of nature, humanity runs the risk of destroying it and becoming in turn a victim of this degradation. So Pope Paul VI was pretty prophetic about a lot of things, and this was something that he kind of sounded the alarm on many years ago. Okay, so this brings up something that some of you might have heard about. You hear of this sometimes in the media, of this concept of an ecological footprint. So what does that mean exactly? Well, essentially, it's trying to quantify how much of an impact we have on Earth's ecosystems. And so you're going to see things like, it incorporates things like the energy we use, the timber we're using, food, and so on. So it's our full impact. And so because of that, generally it's used to refer to how much area, both land and sea, are needed to supply the resources, either to a whole population or to an individual person. So there's calculators out there, like online, you can go to calculate your individual environmental footprint or ecological footprint. But you can also look at it, say, for the whole, like a whole country, what would their environmental footprint be? And what we see is that this varies a lot from one country to the next. And so this map is a few years old, but I think it's pretty, it's recent enough to give us a pretty good idea of the variability. And so the color scales are from lighter, like a real light pink, to a darker, like maroon kind of color. And this was in hectares, but I've calculated the acres here. So the lighter colors that you see here, like India and so on, would be about 2.5 acres for any person to support them. And again, remember that includes land and sea. Versus the darker colors, like the U.S., on average is about 27 acres of land and sea to support that each person. And you can see a lot of variability across the developing world and the developed world. But on average, of course, in the developed world, it takes a lot more land and sea to support each person. And sometimes this concept, this ecological footprint concept, also can be used to see, to kind of say, how long does it take for us to regenerate the resources to use? So in other words, thinking about especially things like timber or the food we're using, how long would it take for those resources to recover? And the last estimate I could find was about 2012, and they estimated that if you look at all the whole population, that we're currently using about 1.6 years to regenerate the resources that people are using in 1 year. So this just kind of indicates that we're if you look globally, that we're not living sustainably right now on the whole, that we're using more resources than can be supported right now, according to these calculations. And these numbers can be run a lot of different ways, but I just wanted to share kind of what's out there in the literature, just to kind of show you what they get at with this concept.
Jason?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, one way you could read that certainly is a place like India or Central Africa there, where there's 2.5 acres to support a person, and, you know, they're very poorly supported. You know,
right.
That seems like that isn't necessarily a good thing. You know, that's less than optimal. Whereas the high end, the 27 acres, you know, there's maybe an indication of overindulgence.
Right.
You know, so, you know.
Yeah, somewhere in the middle.
Mm-hmm. There.
I agree.
I'm not sure exactly what that is, but.
Yeah, that's right. No, that's a very good point. So, you know, I'm certainly not trying to indicate that we should all be down on this end, because I think that's right. You see that there are people that are malnourished in a lot of those countries. So that's a good point. I'm glad you brought that up. Whereas probably in the middle somewhere is what we should be shooting for. I mean, it does take a certain amount of space and water and land to support us. And I don't know what that optimal rate should be, but. That's a good question. I think this is more just like per household or something like that. It's energy, it's food, it's our diet, you know, because we tend to
eat a lot of food that we send over.
Right. Yeah, and I'm going to touch on that in just a sec, but one thing, you know, aside from the energy usage and stuff in developing countries being less, is that say in some place like India, where they tend to be a little bit more of like a vegetarian diet, you've got less land compared to like pastures that would have to be supported for like a, you know, we're fortunate to have a lot of you know, meat and protein available to us, where in some countries that's harder to come by. So that does take a little bit more land for sure. But yeah, as far as the exports go, I don't really know how that plays into these calculations. That's a great question.
The ocean, for that matter, you know, what is drawn from the ocean.
Right. So, just a minute, I'll get more into like the food and water production. And I don't hit on that exactly, but it's something I'll dig into. That's making me wonder now. So one thing that, you know, when we look at energy production, obviously most of our energy right now is not produced, it's not using renewable energy sources. We're starting to head in that direction, but for the most part, it's from like coal, from natural gas, and so on. And I do want to take a moment to say what an amazing source of power fossil fuels are. And just to put it in perspective, I had to look some of this up because I thought it was pretty interesting. So 1 gallon of oil has 138,000 BTUs, British thermal units of energy. If you're like me, you don't think in BTUs a whole lot. So let me break that down for you. So it takes 75 BTUs to boil a cup of water, say, to make your morning coffee. So 1 gallon of oil can boil about 2,000 cups of water. So it's a lot of power. That still may not sound like a lot. It's even more impressive if you relay it to like what humans can do. So say the average human can sustain about 1/10 of a horsepower. Like that's the work that they can do. And so if we translated that amount, that 1 gallon of oil can do about the same amount as one person can do in about 3 months of labor. That's in 1 gallon of oil. So it's not surprising that our whole economy has essentially been built around fossil fuels. I mean, they are an amazing source of power. But we've kind of assumed in that we've got this infinite supply. And the Pope here really is talking about how it's time that we need to realize that these are limited and that they do pollute, that they're highly polluting fuels. And so we need to really look for what lies beyond these. Not to say that we just turn off the tap and, you know, obviously we're using these, this is what our economy is based around, but we can't assume that those supplies are going to be there forever. Because there is a finite amount of all of these, coal, oil, natural gas, and so on. We know, especially in recent years, that we've made some amazing technological improvements for locating those, for extracting these natural resources, and for even burning them more cleanly and efficiently. But it doesn't change the fact that they are finite, and there's only so much of them available. And of course, we know that there are implications for things like smog, for human health, and we talked last week a little bit about climate change. Not that they're necessarily causing climate change, but they probably are playing a role in maybe helping to step on the accelerator of a natural process. So in other words, releasing more of that carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, it is a greenhouse gas, is going to have an effect to some degree, and it's hard for us to say with certainty how much of that's related to just the fossil fuels, but we do know for sure there's no doubt that there are other pollutants that these fuels are emitting. And so the Pope really talks about the need to shift to renewable energy, in particular for more investment, more incentives for research and development in these areas. Because right now, they've come a long way, but they do need sometimes some government money to sometimes help to offset, to look for more efficient ways of using these technologies, and it doesn't make sense to necessarily use them anywhere. So in areas where you have more like open prairies and so on, wind power is a really good idea. Areas like Arizona, here in Florida, solar power might be a good way to go, but sometimes it might need some incentives. But one thing that the Pope does talk about too is there's a need to kind of change of attitude too. So in other words, knowing that our resources are limited, can we look at ways that, say, bundling trips? This isn't a phrase he uses, but it's kind of something that I use. So just thinking about, rather than always, making individual trips for something, can you hold off on something and maybe combine it with two or three other trips that you need to make, just so it's a little bit less, energy that you have to use? Of course, we've seen big strides, a lot more the prices coming down for things like LED lights. That's something here in the parish that we've switched over to a lot more like LED lighting in the church. So, and we can do that at home too, as our incandescent lights are starting to give out, to look for ways. And I think you can even, like places like Amazon and others have them pretty cheap nowadays. So we can look for those kind of things to save a little bit of energy. And one of the things that the Pope also talks about is in areas that are developing. So our economy is already developed in many ways, so it's a little bit harder to change over to a different sources of energy and things. But he particularly encourages clean energy in areas that are developing. And so he talks about this being linked, so the reduction of pollution and development of using more of clean energy in developing areas in particular as being a good solution. And so here's a picture in Africa of a very large solar farm that's producing power for a local community. And that's something that the Pope talks about, is that we do see, even though we haven't gone all the way more towards renewable energies, we're seeing some pretty big advances, and especially in like local areas where they are not only self-sufficient, but they actually are making enough energy in some places to sell surplus energy to other communities and things too. And so he really emphasizes that, even local individuals and groups can make a real big difference in this area. Okay, so moving towards food and fresh water, we live in a world where it's hard to believe in a world that's covered with so much water that we could have this situation, but we do have a situation where out of about 7 billion, believe it or not, 1 billion people don't have access regularly to clean drinking water, and 800 million of them live without adequate nutrition. And the problem isn't necessarily, this is a quote here I'll share from the Pope, and is particular about the quality of water being, in particular, those areas and what the, dysentery, cholera, a lot of health effects, and it's a significant cause of suffering and infant mortality in developing nations. And the surprising thing is here is that there really is enough for everyone, and that's getting more to your point about surplus food in some areas, and is it getting to the people that need it? And that's the problem. The same thing with water and some of the purification kind of techniques is, are they getting to where they're needed? And that's the problem right now. And the Pope talks about this, and he has talked about it not only in Laudato Si, but in other places too, of just in some areas just greed of not letting, the people that are in power in some countries that are developing, not letting those get out to the people that really urgently need those resources. So just to put things in perspective now, of all the fresh water that's available on our planet, we use about 50% of it. So again, there is more fresh water that could be used by people. And believe it or not, it's not like directly human use that's using most of it, but about 80%. I saw that the estimates varied from about 70 to 90, so I'm just taking the middle point there. About 80% of fresh water is used for agriculture to feed our planet. And a lot of this is not done as efficiently as it could be. So this is a picture of center pivot irrigation, which we have a lot of here in the southeast, and especially up in Georgia. If you drive up just north of here, you'll see a lot of this. But this is actually center pivot irrigation in Arizona. So this water is all coming from the Colorado River. And it's irrigating this field. And you can see it if you zoom out a little bit more. Just these circular fields that are in there, and taking another look from like a different angle there. So, you know, this is just basically broadcasting the water evenly everywhere, right? And there are different solutions, and I'll show you in just a minute some of another way of doing it that could make a difference where technology can kind of help. But we do have to see that of all the water that's used for agriculture, I don't have an estimate, but not all of it's used as efficiently as it could be. And maybe it's not even used in the right place. So the Colorado River actually runs dry at certain times of year. It actually does not reach the ocean anymore because so much of it is used for things like this. And again, there's enough food produced for all people to have adequate nutrition, and the problem is making sure it does get to where it's needed. And with all of these things, technology can help, but there's really no silver bullet. A lot of people, I got to steal a phrase that I heard when I was looking into this. They use the phrase silver buckshot, and I think that's a better way to look with a lot of these kind of solutions. There's no silver bullet, but maybe we can find some silver buckshot. So instead of using like a center pivot irrigation kind of approach, we could look at something like drip irrigation, where water is used much more efficiently to get right to the plants that are planted, and you're not, say, spreading water over here or over here, where it's really just going to evaporate. It's not going to go to where it's needed. So that's a solution that can be used. Talking about the quality of water, you know, there may not be money for large water purification plants in some countries, but what has been developed is basically there are tools like this, this basically straw that has in it built in like charcoal filters and some other filters that can help folks to be, even if the water that they're drinking is not as clean as we would like it to be, that this is a way that they can filter out some of those harmful microorganisms so that they can drink the water and safely. And hopefully we would be able to develop some of those larger scale purification of infrastructure as well. But this is something that can go right to individuals to use. And something else that's really coming into its own is precision agriculture. So everybody's pretty familiar with GPS these days. I mean, a lot of us can't get around without it. You know, getting from one place to another, it's becoming more and more beneficial. So one thing that farmers are using more and more, not just here in the US, but all over, is this idea, the same kind of concept of what we're talking about with water, but where should you apply, say, for example, fertilizers in a crop? If you know areas are more productive or don't need as much water, you're gonna basically be able to kind of more smartly distribute how you're applying fertilizer, or maybe making sure that you know, you're watering a part of the crop more than you would another. And so that's kind of getting at this idea of precision agriculture, using that information. And believe it or not, a lot of that's built into like combines and things nowadays. It's they practically drive themselves. I've got a lot of family up in Indiana, and it's amazing how technical a lot of the farming equipment has become in the last several decades. But again, here, another also change of attitude can help. And so, you know, we just have to ask some questions to look at things. Like, do we really need to grow lettuce in the desert of Arizona? Is that the best use of, say, the water from the Colorado River? And also, do we have to have bottled water from Fiji? Or is our own tap water or water from, say, a more local source a better use? So, you know, not to say that these things are wrong, but just to weigh them and to say, you know, to use them more efficiently and to think about these kind of things. And so the Pope talks about this is really especially, again, looking at developing areas and trying to help them to come up with these systems, to be able to have not only agriculture, but making sure it's sustainable. So he's talking about irrigation that's needed and, you know, the techniques that are developed. And this one thing that's encouraging is that, like, for example, there are a lot of people from the U.S. government that go over and work with developing nations and try to help them to use some of these techniques that we use to learn from, like, our best management practices so that they their soil's using sustainably. They're learning how to let crops go fallow and then, you know, rotate through them and so on. And so that's something that's pretty encouraging, that people from Europe, people from America are going to some developing countries to try to help them to use these kind of techniques. And so again, this just kind of points to being able to encourage more local and sustainable food production is a good way to go, because if you have different, say at the village level, if they can making sure that they're getting all the food and water that they need, that then they're not going to be dependent on food to come from elsewhere, that, you know, and you don't have all the transportation costs and so on. So the more that we can encourage that, the better. All right, another area of creation that we could look at, of nurturing, is this concept of biodiversity. And this is a word that gets tossed around a lot, but not defined a whole lot. And so what do we mean by biodiversity? Well, really what we're talking about is the variety and variability of life on Earth or in a particular area. So it's just the different kinds of species that are present, anything from insects to plants to animals to even like fungi, you know, mushrooms and things out there. All of those would contribute to biodiversity. And the Pope talks about biodiversity in the encyclical too. And so what's the big deal about losing biodiversity? Well, one thing that the Pope points out is that the loss of forests and woodlands entails the loss of species which may constitute extremely important resources in the future, not only for food, but also for curing disease and other uses. And in the early days of pharmaceutical research, almost all of it was based on plants and deriving compounds from plants, and also, of course, things like penicillin from molds. But nowadays, more of it's produced chemically, so there's not as much research going into this. But you know, one thing is for sure, that there's a lot more probably untapped resources out there that we haven't even begun to explore, that we've kind of moved more into just doing it in the lab. But you know, there are a lot of medicine men and shamans and things that they could probably teach us quite a lot. And so there are people, ethnobotanists out there working with them to try to understand how they're treating illnesses, how they're treating different conditions, and then looking at making sure that those particular plants that they're using are preserved, like collecting seeds from them, so that even if the forest, for some reason, you know, if it's developed and lost, that we would be able to save those species. And you know, even aside from this, we the more research we do in ecology, the more we see that each species plays a distinct role in the ecosystem. So this concept of like an ecological niche, a particular job that a species has, and we there's not a whole lot of excess in anything in creation. Okay, first, there's a reason that particular organism exists. We may not understand it, but the more you start to look at the interconnection between different critters out there, the more you see that they really do rely on each other. We tend to think about ecology as being a lot of, you know, because we've all seen these nature specials, and we think about it as competition and really hard and survival of the fittest. And there is certainly some of that, but also there's a lot of cooperation out there, a surprising amount of cooperation. So this is just one example of two different species of trees, and the research is showing that in times, let's say, for example, when a beech tree would have no leaves, it can actually get nutrients from a Norway spruce. The spruce tree would actually share resources with it, and vice versa. In times where the Norway spruce might be lacking in carbohydrates, this species could share it with them. These are two different species, but through their roots, they share a lot of nutrients, a lot of water, and surprisingly, not just for say, species like a offspring of this particular species, but between both of them, they also share resources. And one thing that we are seeing is that, you know, ecosystems are very resilient, but the loss of species permanently can have irreversible effects. And so we have to be careful about that. And this brings us back to this idea. Last week, I talked a little bit about the Endangered Species Act. And the Endangered Species Act is usually just, you know, it's focused on, say, a particular species. But when you combine this with this concept of biodiversity and not wanting to lose species because of the role they play, you see even more why that's important, why each species is important to protect. And, you know, the Florida scrub jay that I showed at the beginning, there are, for a lot of different ecosystems, there are a handful of species that are protected. And as long as we're doing right by those, usually we're doing right for everything else, too. So Endangered Species Act has kind of trickle-down effects. It does benefit a lot of other species, too, that may not be singled out. And just wanted to end with on biodiversity with talking about this is that it's a long quote. I'll break it down for you. Is that basically what the Pope says here is that even when we can't, we shouldn't always just think about species and looking at it for resources that can be exploited. And when we think about each year seeing the disappearance of species that are, you know, say our grandkids are never going to see, that we should really never let that happen. You know, each one of those species gives glory to God by their very existence. And so he encourages us that even if there's not necessarily anything in it for us, it's still part of creation. God has created it, wants it to be there. And so we need to do what we can to help protect biodiversity. There are a lot of solutions out there. And, you know, as with a lot of these issues, you know, we know that the poorest in the world are the most vulnerable. But, you know, one thing I do want to say is necessity is the mother of all invention. And here, I'm going to call on a TV hero, MacGyver, okay? So if anybody who ever saw that show MacGyver, and I think there's a new version that I haven't seen, but the old show, you know, he could have like some duct tape, you know, some kind of like a little wire, and somehow he could make a bomb to get himself out of something, out of a fix. And so there are some, I'm only going to show a handful, but there's some really creative solutions that people in developing countries have come up with to deal with issues. So first one here, this is an example in Bolivia. And this is actually a billboard that collects humidity and makes water from, so the water that's in the air, that's what humidity is, gets basically condensed by this billboard, and it's actually freely available to people that live in this community. It's not a ton of water, but this is a really arid, dry area. They're near the Pacific coast, so they actually do get some humidity at certain times. And so, let me see if I can see here. This area, this is an area that, it's not in Bolivia, it's in Lima, Peru. I'm sorry about that. But it receives very little rainfall, and about 700,000 people live in this city without access to regular drinking water. But this was just a kind of a proof of concept. In this particular thing, this billboard alone can make about 2,500 gallons of water in a span of, I think this was 1 month in March when it came online. And supposedly, this only cost about $1,200 to install, which sounds like, it may sound like a fair bit of money, but this is something that I think is, you're going to see more and more of this. You know, just getting water from the air is a brilliant idea. It's water that's there already. Making it available is a pretty neat concept. Another example here, this is pretty recently. I just saw this one a few weeks ago. But this is from an island in American Samoa that was totally dependent on diesel fuel to power the island. And sometimes those shipments wouldn't come in. There'd be a delay or whatever, and so the whole island would be basically out of power, so they'd have like rolling outages. So they worked with Solar City, a company that's owned by Elon Musk, who also does the Tesla cars and so on, and they've installed this. It only took them a few months to install, and now 100% of the island's power is coming from renewable energy, and basically they are only using the diesel as a backup. So this thing, because of these, this microgrid, let's see, they have these Tesla power packs, 60 of them, that can store energy for many days, even if it's completely cloudy. So this is kind of a cool story that in a remote area, that this makes a heck of a lot of sense. So I thought that was pretty neat.
Jason, are those solar panels?
There? Yeah, solar panels, and then I think this is kind of like the capacitors, like storing it, yeah. So it's kind of neat. So they still do get diesel, but it's really more for like a backup now. And then the last example that I came across was this. Now, anybody, any guesses what this is?
A fruit dryer?
It's actually a refrigerator that doesn't need any energy. So this is in India, we were just talking about. And this Indian entrepreneur made a refrigerator entirely from clay that keeps food cool for days without any electricity. And so what it's doing is it's using the natural cooling effect of water. So you pour a little bit of water in here, and the natural kind of, as this drips down, tends to pull the heat away and along the clay and keeps it cool. So it talks about how even like milk can be kept cool for 3 to 5 days. And it requires no energy, and there are other companies that are making similar products now, so it's really taken off over there. But I thought that was pretty neat too. So again, necessity, the mother of all invention. I think there's a lot of creative MacGyver type folks out there, and I love to see this kind of thing. So one of the things that Pope talks about, which I really liked, is, you know, can we learn from creation? And he points out how, you know, natural ecosystems, I mentioned a minute ago, that they're very efficient. They don't waste a lot of energy. So if you look at how, say, grasses are consumed by herbivores, or herbivores, when they die, are decomposed, there's not a lot of waste. The energy, there's a little bit of heat given off, but they're very efficient, very circular in terms of how the nutrients and energy are reused by other organisms. And he asks, can we learn something about that? You know, he points out, and you probably heard this phrase that's been used by Pope Francis, but talking about, you know, counteracting our throwaway culture. You know, how can we adapt more of a circular model with our production and learn from how nature already is designed this way by our Creator? Can we learn from nature and do something similar? And we're starting to. So this is just an example from a plant that's actually trying to convert, instead of just going to landfill, burning parts of that waste to produce more energy. There's more examples also of areas that are reclaiming water, using that for irrigation. We see that in different cases. So I think this is something that we're seeing more of, you know, looking at how is nature doing it? How has God created the natural world to do it? What can we learn from that? And how can we maybe adapt that kind of approach? And this kind of just brings up this idea of designing with nature. And so these are actually what are called green roofs. So if you ever, for anybody that's ever been to like a big city in the summer, it's hot. You know, you get all this asphalt, all this concrete and everything, and it's reflecting a lot of heat. And so green roofs are a way of not only kind of reducing overall heat that's in an urban environment, but actually saving a lot of money, believe it or not. By growing a green roof, it can reduce the energy cost quite a bit. And there's other benefits too, like you don't have this stormwater runoff from these impervious surfaces. They're actually used by the plants on the roof. And believe it or not, I saw one, so on say a hot summer day, the surface temperature of a green roof can be cooler than the air temperature, whereas the surface of a conventional rooftop can be up to 90 degrees warmer. So, you know, not only, you know, just a big difference there. And of course, you can imagine then that the benefits and costs would be associated with that. And a lot of the studies that show this are showing that they do pay for themselves over time. And so this is something that some cities are starting to implement, some incentive programs to encourage people to develop this more. And of course, even for areas where we don't have green roofs, we can look at the benefits of that trees provide in urban areas. So that's a little blurry, but just to point out a few things, you know, for also, you know, providing some shade, for lowering the amount of, you know, the temperature around these areas, but for providing some wildlife habitat, reducing surface flood water runoff. So they actually are going to take up a lot of that water that goes into the soil, and many other benefits too. But so those would be some some areas that you know, urban trees can provide too. And a couple of concepts that or some designs I found that were pretty cool. This is a plans for a building that was recently built on Georgia Tech's campus. And so I won't go into a whole lot of detail here, but what I wanted to show you here was that they've actually are kind of working with the way that the water would normally flow into this wetland. They are actually using the water, they're using it in a couple of ways. So they have different areas where they're reclaiming the water and using that to irrigate a lot of the plants that are around this building. But they're also using some of the water like rainfall and also what's called gray water. So let's say you wash your hands in a sink, that water goes down. It can be used for other things too, with some little bit of processing like for flushing toilets and so on. So they're really trying to use the water, reclaim water more efficiently. And just to show you like what it looks like after it was done, you know, to kind of design a little bit more with nature and using these wetlands like they should be to kind of hold the water and to reclaim the water to use elsewhere. And this is something that you've probably seen even here at church, this idea of a rain garden. We're seeing more and more of those, and this is a great idea. So what we're basically looking at here is an area where, especially near like a paved parking lot, water can run off, and it can be slowed down, and actually can be cleaned, essentially. That's what wetlands do, is they kind of act like kidneys to clean the water before it goes back into like an aquifer. And so ideas where rain gardens can kind of use some of that water, slow down the flow. If you've got like sand or something that's washing across a parking lot, those particles can be taken up by the rain garden. They're not going to be washed right into like a river. And then the water is cleaned before it goes into the aquifer, back into our drinking water. And so this is something that, you know, especially areas near lakes are starting to do more of this. And so this is actually a plan, some designs from this isn't built yet, but in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. They're, right now, a lot of these areas, this is near campus, on the Louisiana State University's campus, and so they, you know, typical, kind of like a open grassy lot that just ends at the lake, and a lot of the water just runs right off, a lot of the fertilizers and stuff just go right off, and so what they want to try to do is design more with nature to put these kind of green spaces in where people can enjoy them a little bit more, but also you have this natural kind of filter before it gets down into the lake. Of say runoff would come down, and of course breeding birds, wading birds, you know, can use that habitat too. But we also know that in addition to things like this, wetlands can play a big role in like storm, like along a coastal area. If you've got hurricanes that are coming in, Louisiana made me think of this just now, that leaving those wetlands can help protect those more insular like communities, those areas that are more you know, away from the coast, to kind of break up those storm surges and so on. So one thing that we have to be careful of is the extremes. Okay, so I've talked a little bit about technology and designing with nature, and we can get into this idea of science and technology will solve all the problems. You know, we're going to find that silver bullet or maybe silver buckshot. And I'm a sci-fi geek, okay? So I love Star Trek, and I love the idea of being able to just walk up to something and say tea Earl Grey hot and boom, it's there. You know, I've got exactly, or I want a glass of water. And energy is converted into whatever I want. So obviously this solution would be incredible if we had this, right? Because then we could just make food, water, whatever. Maybe we'll get there someday, but that's not going to happen probably in my lifetime anyway. But another, maybe a little less, or a little bit more pessimistic view of the future could be more like Wally, okay? So we're going to just make a mess and then leave poor Wally behind to clean it up. And meanwhile, we're going to blast on out of here and go on basically a cruise in space here. So either one of these would be looking at how technology is going to kind of just solve all of our problems. And the Pope cautions us against this. He says that basically it's not that technology is bad, but we have to be cautious of looking at technology without realizing how we're called also to deeply change kind of our view of how we relate to nature. But he cautions against the other extreme too. So the other extreme would be humans are the problems. They must be controlled at all costs. And believe it or not, we do see some of that, where people view basically humanity as being no different than any kind of other animal, and having, you know, that we want to be able to control them and prohibit them from interacting with nature, or that they need to be stopped. And there are actually cases in England and Europe, even in the Pacific Northwest, of some groups that resort to what's called eco-terrorism. And we don't want to go to that extreme either, of thinking that we have no right to be the stewards of nature, that we have no right to use the resources that God has given us. Okay, we want to find some solutions. But I think the key is right here, this looking at this change. That's what the Pope is trying to get us to think about. And again, this gets back to this idea of integral ecology. So looking at our connections with nature and with each other too. And this last part of this quote is really what I wanted to drive home here, is that our relationship with the environment can never be isolated from our relationship with each other and with God. And so this brings us, you know, kind of at the extreme was that some people think, well, if humans are the problem, that we need to limit them as much as possible. And so abortion and, you know, population control is the answer. But what the Pope talks about is everything is interrelated. And so we can't say, we can't separate the protection from nature with then justifying it and saying that abortion is okay, you know. If we fail to protect, for example, a human embryo, the dignity of a person that's vulnerable, even when the presence is uncomfortable or creates difficulties, you know, we can't justify that. And similarly, is that we have to be concerned for the poor. And in here, he goes beyond just saying it's just a financially giving them money, but what we really need to look at is to allow them to have a dignified life through work, okay? So community gardens, things like that, are a great way, rather than just getting money that a lot of times, especially in poor areas here in the U.S. even, goes towards food that's not that healthy. I heard a great story on the radio of a guy that's really working with a lot of local communities making community gardens in South Central Los Angeles. And he started with just his house, and he was made fun of and everything. He had gotten out of prison and really liked produce. He really liked to grow his own food. And now it's taken off. He's working with all these school kids. He's making community gardens everywhere. A lot of kids are really getting into it. And so things like that, I think, are kind of in line with what the Pope's trying to encourage there. And towards the end of the encyclical, he gets into this idea of educating, but also getting in touch more with God. And so this quote I really like here is that environmental education should facilitate making the leap towards the transcendent, which gives ecological ethics its deepest meaning. And so again, you know, really trying to encourage us to not just look at ecology and caring for the environment as an isolated problem, you know, of just realizing that it's an issue that we are called to do because we are the stewards of creation. And so realizing that God is very much in the middle of this issue, and that we are called to very much realize that we're in solidarity with both the poor but also with all of creation. And of course, who better to represent that than Saint Francis himself, of course, you know, taking this very much to heart, going out preaching to the animals, very much seeing, caring for them, and seeing our care for them as being something that we're called to do. And, you know, the Pope also just basically calls us to say, to look at the ultimate solution as being, because we are Christians, we do believe that God loves creation so much that he became part of it, okay? And so looking at Christ as being really at the center of this ecological conversion, okay? And so Christ didn't just renew us, humanity, but renews all of creation. And so this quote from Pope Francis, and I meant to look up what part of Laudato Si this was from. I'm sorry, if anybody's really interested, I'll look that up. But Christ has taken unto himself this material world, and now risen, is intimately present to each being, surrounding it with his affection and penetrating it with his light. So again, bringing it back to where we started, that creation was not only created at the beginning out of love, but it's sustained through love, it's redeemed through love. And that is really in a nutshell what the Pope is trying to get us back to, is to thinking about our relationship to nature as being kind of best personified through Christ and also through some of the saints that really helped to draw us into that solidarity with all creatures, with all of humanity, and realizing what we're called to be. So just to kind of wrap up this second part here, Again, we are called to be prudent stewards of creation. And so one of the things that the Pope says is that, you know, living our vocation to be protectors of God's handiwork is essential to a life of virtue. It's not optional. It's not a secondary act of our Christian experience. It's very much a part of what we are called to do, a part of our vocation. And of course, we're deeply connected to nature, but each other as well. And, you know, we rely on creation, even if we may not realize it, even if we're in the middle of a city where we may not see a whole lot of nature around us, we still rely on creation to provide the food and water, the clean air that's coming to that city, maybe from someplace else, but it's still very much a part of something that we're very reliant on creation for this. And so part of this then too is that we have to realize the dignity of the poor and of all people. And so realizing that we are very much called to be stewards of not only the natural world, but being very much in solidarity with people in all parts of the world as well. And again, I wish there was a silver bullet, but there's really no silver bullet. There's maybe silver buckshot. And so let's look at a few of those just to kind of reiterate what we've been talking about. So technology has made amazing advancements, but I think it's technology and learning from creation, especially those two together, are going to make some pretty big strides. And so I tried to show a couple of examples there where designing with nature, and we can use the technology, but trying to do it particularly with learning from how is creation already designed. God was pretty smart. He knew what he was doing. So we want to learn from this creator and say, maybe there's something we can learn here. Also, this concept, so this technology, learning from creation, integral ecology, realizing that we're very much a part of it, realizing how much we depend on it, and especially that no matter where we are, we're still tied to nature. And so this is another one of those Discover the Forest, but we're also really trying to do a lot of outreach with our ads to particularly to Hispanics and to minorities that are growing in population to really help them to understand why it's important to protect forests and to really understand this better with their classes and so on. And so making this a part of their ecological education, what they're learning about, but not seeing this as disconnected from some of those deeper conversions that need to happen, the attitude change that we need to have, and seeing that very much the center of this is the idea of renewing our relationship with Christ. Again, Christ being the Redeemer of humanity and of all creation, and just seeing that through Christ that we can become probably better stewards of his creation. Okay, so I'm going to stop there for a minute and see if there's any questions on what I've talked about. I know we're kind of getting close on time, but I wanted to stop there. And if I have time, I'll show you a couple of examples and some stuff that's right here in our backyard. But if we don't have time, that's fine too. So any questions?
I think you have 5 minutes if you want to go right into what you have available that's showing us what's going on here locally.
Okay. All right. Cool. So I talk about this. This is really really just getting off the ground, but this is a part of the Apalachicola Regional Restoration Initiative. A lot of partners involved from the state, from local government, and so on. But it's kind of neat. And I just want to point out that we really do have a treasure right here in our backyard, folks. Apalachicola region is really a national treasure. We have some of the highest biodiversity in all of North America, but actually, believe it or not, in some areas of Apalachicola National Forest, there's so much diversity that it's actually on par with the tropics. A lot of people don't realize that. A lot of it's in the ground cover. There's a lot of diversity of plants in right here in our backyard. And so, again, kind of one of the things that the Pope saw that I was jumping up and down when I read this, I thought it was really cool, is that certain areas which are shown to be richer in the number of species and the endemic or rare or less protected species are even more important. And we have a ton of these. Endemic means basically they're found nowhere else. They're unique to a particular area. And so just to show you a few of those, I mentioned this little critter last week. This is Harper's Beauty. It's just a lily here that's found, as far as we know now, only on the Apalachicola National Forest, nowhere else. And we've tried to put a lot more of those locations on the map. We've done a lot more survey work to find out where they're at, to try to understand. Unfortunately, a lot of them occur along Highway 65, which someday could be widened. So we're also doing some work to look at how well we could maybe move those plants off of the shoulder of the road and put them into natural forest. And they're doing really well, which is really cool. That's kind of a side tangent. Sorry about that. But then we have frosted flatwood salamanders, which are, again, pretty much the majority of the population is on Apalachicola National Forest. They are found in other areas, but they're also on St. Mark's, but lots of ponds there on the Apalachicola National Forest. And there are lots of others too. Those are just two that I'm showing. But this is also, we're actually right in the heart of the longleaf pine area, which at one time spanned all the way from up in Virginia all the way to Texas, 90 million acres. Today we have less than 4 million acres of it around, and we're trying to do a lot more restoration with this longleaf. And I could tell you why that's happened, but just to kind of get, I think we have some of the prettiest longleaf in the whole range right here in our backyard as well. And we're very blessed that this is relatively undeveloped. We still got a lot of forested areas up here in the Panhandle. A lot of this area is under public land ownership. And this area is really very important both for local and regional economy, things like timber, tourism, commercial fisheries, and so on. So that's just a little background on the place. What we're trying to do is basically some of the funding that's coming in from the BP and Deepwater Horizon, the oil spill that happened, that money is just starting to flow in, and we're really trying to use it to do a pretty large-scale restoration across a lot of different landowners. And this is going to be improved on more water quantity and better quality water getting into the Apalachicola River, which is really important for our oyster fisheries. Believe it or not, about 10% of all the oysters in America come out of the Apalachicola Bay. We're going to do more longleaf restoration, some targeted endangered species habitat restoration. And overall, this will improve the health of Apalachicola River and Bay as well. And so we're going to look at what the needs are out there. Some of this area used to be owned by commercial timber organizations, especially on Tateshill State Forest. So we're looking at doing what we can to improve the flow of water. And to make it more like natural, like it should flow. We're looking at a lot of water. The plantations that are slash pine plantations pull a ton of water out of the ground. We're trying to go more towards longleaf restoration so that it uses a lot less water, a lot more water goes into the aquifer and then into the river. And as far as longleaf and endangered species restoration, we're gonna be over the next probably 10 to 15 years probably restoring as much as 70 or 80,000 acres of longleaf habitat. And then also we're trying to make sure that these areas are fire dependent, so we're gonna try to do more prescribed fire. And we burn on average a couple of 100,000 acres already a year in this area, but we wanna up that and do even more. And we're gonna do, in some cases, you can't get there just from fire. So we're going to do targeted restoration in particular areas. So these flatwood salamanders that I talked about a minute ago rely on breeding ponds that should look like this. So they have a nice grassy area going into where they lay their eggs. And then when the rains come, they lay them when they're dry. When the rains come, they can hatch in there. And these are what they're called ephemeral ponds. So these ponds actually do dry out. And because of that, they don't have any predators in them. We're trying to take ponds that look like this, and we've already done some of this on dozens of ponds out there, but this money will really help us to be able to do a lot more of that kind of work. And we're doing that with the Florida Fish and Wildlife Conservation Commission. And doing a lot more to protect my friend there, Harper's Beauty, little quote there, which I'm from Dietrich von Hildenbrand. Kind of getting at what the Pope was mentioning is that we shouldn't just look at any species. I don't know any benefits for Harper's Beauty, but it is nice that it exists, and I want to make sure that we're doing what we can to protect this species. No, I'm running out of time, so let me speed. Out of time. Okay. So one last thing. All of this is going to be, the Pope talks about a lot of things that are happening, really need to be open and transparent. And all of what we're doing, we're going to have a lot of it on the web. There's going to be tools that all of our partners can use to prioritize the work that's going to happen. And all of it's going to have public involvement at every step of the way. And that's one of the things we're really blessed with in this country, to have a lot of environmental steps that really make everything we do, every federal dollar that's spent out there for this kind of restoration, it's available for the public to comment on, and that's part of this NEPA process. So it's pretty exciting, but in general, it's going to hopefully make a pretty big difference. But we'll go ahead and close in prayer here. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, God of love, show us our place in this world as channels of your love for all creatures of this earth. For not one of them is forgotten in your sight. Enlighten those who possess power and money that they may avoid the sin of indifference, that they may love the common good, advance the weak, and care for this world in which we live. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.